It's an individual who seems to always have an articulate response to unknown questions. It's an individual who's confident without being arrogant. And it takes someone who's very self-aware, quick on their feet, and truthfully unflappable. When I know I have important conversations or presentations coming up, you do prepare. Everybody's watching how people are reacting to things. You really have to be self-aware of how you want people to perceive you. They know exactly how to navigate a conversation. They know how to come across as convincing. How did I get there? The truth was, I was genuine. I always lived up to my words. Never once in my career have I ever done that. I've never been a threatening type personality. If you live by your values and people start to see it, you'll naturally progress. I think reputation should always precede you in the best way. Your network really does matter. Treating people with respect today will pay dividends at some point in the future.
Rich Jacques is in the top echelon of business leaders today. His incredible career spans decades and includes senior leadership roles at Belcan and Booz Allen Hamilton, where he spent 21 years. Today, he's the Vice President of Intelligence and Law Enforcement at Noblis, a nonprofit advisory company that specializes in cutting-edge science and technology solutions and research. In 2020, Rich was named one of the top five executives in intelligence contracting by the Potomac Officers Club, and it's no surprise. Rich is easily one of the most subtle, savvy, and intelligent leaders out there today. Come and get an insider's look at how the most sophisticated professionals think, act, lead, and move their careers forward. Pull out your journal and take good notes as we do a deep dive into the savvy professional. Welcome to the LifeWorks podcast. So I want to jump right in here. How do you define a savvy or sophisticated professional? What does sophisticated look like to you?
That's a great question. And honestly, in my mind, it's a person who makes it look effortless to navigate, you know, complex and challenging situations. It's someone who's able to have hard conversations and achieve the intended outcome. It's an individual who seems to always have an articulate response to unknown questions, and they earn trust in the process. They come across very genuine. It's an individual who's confident without being arrogant, and it takes someone who's very self-aware, quick on their feet, and truthfully unflappable. You have to just be very steady through every situation and have that level of confidence that just inspires trust and confidence in being a sophisticated professional.
How do you execute that yourself?
So it's mentally very draining. There's a lot of processing that has to happen in the moment. So because you can't always predict how a conversation is going to turn, you're going to deal with different personalities all the time. So really having a high degree of emotional intelligence, understanding how to read people, how to listen, how to ask the right questions, and essentially provide feedback in that moment that is not off base and off putting and really comes to an intended outcome where everybody walks away from the conversation satisfied.
Do you think it's innate in us, driven by personality, or do you think anyone can develop it?
So I'll answer the latter first. I think it can be developed. Now, is it innate and driven by personality? Absolutely. And so that's the hard part. I think it's, so if you think about building a house, you have to have the foundation pretty solid first. And so it does take a degree of a personality. You can't be on one end or the other end of the spectrum. You have to be right in the middle and understanding, okay, how do I take this ability and grow, right? And I think from my perspective, because I didn't start out this way in my career. I've been asked this question before. They're like, well, how do you handle it? How did you learn how to do this? And the truth is I did learn how to do it. But when you start out, you find the people that you admire. You see how they navigate situations. And so having a mentor is always very important. But I think there's one individual that I can think back in my career who I used to watch and observe. And the way that he handled situations with clients, with staff, and we jokingly said he had a silver tongue. He just had the ability to navigate every conversation in such a way you're like, oh my gosh, that was good. And so you learn by watching, you learn by observing, and then you have to put it into practice. And then when you put it into practice, you also have to have a feedback mechanism. So part of that learning process is, hey, you've taught me how to ride a bike, Mark, but how am I doing it? Am I all over the place? Am I shaky, backwards, right? You have to have someone that you can trust that will give you feedback in the moment too. So right after, I had a person that did this for me. I would say, hey, how'd that meeting go? How did I do? Did I come across the right way? Was the message correct? And so you just have to hone it over time. So it is something that can be learned.
So you actually mentioned it earlier about it being mentally exhausting. How much time do you spend planning and thinking?
It's a great question. And I am a planner just by my nature. If I'm thinking about my day today, I already know the schedule and I know, okay, I got to back this up. I've got to do this. So just by my personality, I do like to plan, but I think how much time do I spend thinking about meetings? So when I know I have important conversations or presentations coming up, like most of us, you do prepare. I don't rehearse in front of a mirror per se, but I do some of my best thinking. And unfortunately it's when I'm not working. So I'm driving in my car. If I, believe it or not, in the shower, I have clarity you can't believe. So even though it's steamy and foggy in that shower, I am so clear. And so I generally try to keep a notepad right in my bathroom area, right by my closet. I have one by my bed because sometimes as I'm going to sleep, I'll be thinking and thinking about the script and the narrative. Right? So the answer is a lot of planning, right? Whether I do it intentionally or not, it's very hard to turn off my mind sometimes when I'm prepared mentally for something. And so at the end of the week, so sometimes on Friday evenings, I just sit and it's almost like I have to just stare at a wall. I don't do that, but you all have to find a way to just unplug. You have to turn your brain off. And sometimes it's by finding something else that's completely unwork-related just to distract you, just because it does drain you over a series of a work week.
If you were to draw kind of a pie chart of how you spend your typical day, week, month, year, maybe this is generalizable, but how would you divide it between all the major activities that you do, like planning, organizing, networking, communicating, and doing? How would you divide that pie chart? Roughly.
Communicating probably takes up the majority of my time. So if I had to draw a pie chart, it's easily over 60%. And because that's fundamentally how I get work done. It's how I get things done, is I have to talk to people all the time. And people have to talk to me. So case in point, like I said, Friday evenings, I'm trying to unplug and get done. And I've got instant messages coming in. Hey, you got a minute? And I'm like, ugh. So the point being, trust me, I don't mind it. But it's easily over 60%. And then if I had to draw out the other slices in that pie, I would say probably networking is roughly about maybe 10%. Organizing, probably 10%. It's just about an 80%. And planning is probably a good portion of the remainder. So it goes back to, it's really hard for me to say how much I plan because unfortunately I do it in my unconscious activities. And so it does consume a lot of you never turn off your computer, but yet it might sleep a little bit, but in the background, there's still some processing going on.
So one of the things that I've been curious about is this concept of executive presence. And I think it's something that you have. What does that look like to you and how do we develop it?
This is probably a topic I mentor a lot of people on because there's such a importance to this that I try to share with people. As a up and coming leader, people are looking at you, right? All the time. They listen to you, they hear what you say, they see how you react, they're looking at how you present yourself. And the reality is people are going to emulate what they see in you as a leader. And this gets back to the point I was saying earlier about being unflappable, right? So there's always going to be situations that are stressful, that cause reactions to where people tend to easily overreact and get excited. And you can get frustrated, you can get angry, you can get sad. There's a lot of emotions that can happen in these things. And as a leader, you really have to have that ability to have that sort of steady state. You have to understand, you have to listen, you have to process what's happening, and then come up with a course of action. And if you come across as extremely frustrated or mad or angry, or you don't like something, you see that trickle down through the teams. And so that executive presence matters. Because people are looking at you to set the example. How are you handling the situation? How should we be handling the situation? If you watch the news and you see a leader flipping out, you're like, oh my gosh. Your case in point, the weatherman goes, man, this is going to be a massive blizzard. Everybody's like, oh my God, it's going to be a massive blizzard. And everybody runs to the store. Everybody's watching how people are reacting to things. And unfortunately, there's sort of a follow culture that happens where people are watching and reacting to things they hear and see. And so that executive presence matters. You really have to be self-aware of how you want people to perceive you. You have to be aware of how you want to be perceived. So that gets back to that mental processing. It's hard because you have to be aware of all of these things all the time. And for you to have that ability to come across as calm, collected, and hey, we'll take care of this. We got a plan. People will go, all's good.
An interesting phenomenon is, and you've seen them at the senior levels, as you've been in many senior level environments over the years, is that it's very easy for people with very strong personalities to rise quickly, or just to rise, you know, to the top levels of the organization. What do you attribute that to? And sometimes they're not even qualified to be there, but because they have a strong personality, they end up rising. What explains that phenomenon in your mind?
So there's a lot that has to deal with confidence, right? And whether that confidence is really justified in experience, because there's a lot of people that are very smooth talkers. They know exactly how to navigate a conversation. They know how to come across as convincing. And people tend to believe it, right? When you interview a candidate, you look at the resume, you're like, oh, this looks impressive. And during an interview, people are always on their best behavior. And if they say all the right things, you're like, this person is fully qualified for the job and I feel great about hiring them. Then lo and behold, they get into a position and you start to see, oh, wow, this person's lazy. They don't do this. There's things that you're convinced in the moment of individuals. So these people that have these very convincing personalities that have that ability to come across as very confident, they can navigate their way to get to the top. Now, eventually the truth does come out, right? This is something that, that it's an act that cannot continue in perpetuity, which is basically something that people will find out the true nature of an individual over time. So I agree with you. I've seen a lot of people who are like, how in the world did they get into that position? And maybe they have pictures. Who knows? But yeah, there's people that are just really good at negotiation and they can figure out ways to get what they want. And then to the end, they generally have to move along. They can't stay in one place too long because it is uncovered.
How does a person become that influential voice in the room?
So there's a lot of confidence that has to come with that. But I think it's a fine balance between being confident and being arrogant. You know, because again, people are watching you. People are understanding who you are and what you say. And so honestly, it comes where you have to build a followership. And so through the dialogue that you have to come across as genuine, trustworthy, you have to understand, obviously, the business you're in, right? You have to be able to, you know, articulate, hey, here's how this is going to work. This is what I would suggest. But I think also being inclusive, right? Because again, you can't get there without people behind you. So as I talk about followership, I think this is a really key leadership tenet in my mind is if you're not helping people and including them to help get to a solution, you're building them up for success. And in turn, that builds you up for success. And so that in my mind is really the only way that you can truly be successful. Because if you don't have the people behind you trusting you and knowing that you're helping them to get somewhere that they want, I don't think you can elevate up.
Was confidence something that you had or did you have to develop it?
It's constantly developing, right? So I think it's like a sine wave. There's days where you're like, man, I got this. I know what I'm doing. And then there's days that you have a lot of self-doubt. You're like, man, I'm doing the right thing. And you feel like there's a little bit of a drain that maybe you're not doing all the things you should be. But again, I think that is attributed back to self-awareness, because I think if you don't have those checkpoints in your own mind about where you are on a certain situation, that gets to that kind of overconfidence. And you definitely don't want to get too much into that because that results in arrogance. That results in people going, this guy's always overconfident. And so I think there's a point where, again, you have to navigate those waves. But I have days where I question myself. I'm like, do I really understand the problem? Do I really know what I'm doing? And you have to have those mental checkpoints is really a validation is, okay, what should I be doing? Or maybe I should be so-and-so. Maybe you come up with a list of alternatives. And again, I think when you validate some of those things, that confidence comes right back, right? And said, okay, I did do the right thing. So I think I don't think there's any leader who's always confident. There's always situations that you have to have a moment of validation and a little bit of doubt as to, what else could be done? Do I really understand what I need to do in this situation?
Where do you derive your confidence from?
I think it goes back to the communication, right? So when I talk with individuals, that gets back to, hey, what do you think about this? So if we were having a conversation and I was a little bit in that moment of maybe self-doubt about a situation, or maybe I didn't have the highest level of confidence, I would validate it through conversations with people and say, what do you think about this? And a lot of times, and you probably hear this every day, someone will say, that's a really great idea. And it regenerates that confidence level back. And so I think a lot of it's through communication, quite honestly, because you can operate in a vacuum, because you might think, hey, my approach sounds like a solid approach. But at the end of the day, if it fails, it hurts your confidence level. So I genuinely think that you have to be collaborative and you have to bounce things off of people. And that's generally where I think confidence is derived.
Walk us through a typical day for you, starting with your morning routine and ending with your evening routine.
So there's a pre-pandemic lifestyle and then there's a pandemic lifestyle. And finding my day is different now than it used to be. And I think it's not a bad thing. So when you think about the ability for an individual to change, so early in my career, pre-pandemic, I worked for organizations that had a large military leadership component to it. And military was, hey, we're having our meeting at 6:30. And you're like, oh my God, 6:30 in the morning. I remember these days vividly as I was like, I got to set my alarm for 5. I got to get up. I got to commute. And over the years, I just got used to that routine. And so I was an early riser. I did have more clarity in the morning. I do claim to be a morning person, so I get most of my thinking done. So how I'm getting to the answer is I try to block time in the morning for me to collect my thoughts for the day. So it gets a little back to that planning phase. So I got into the habit early of being an early riser, but I found that's when I could actually plot my day. And unfortunately, I'm a list person, right? So I always have a list and I have multiple lists. I have a list of the things I know I've got to get done, but don't necessarily have to be done in the day. And then I have a daily list. And the daily list is really, I got to get these things done today. So I spend generally mostly about an hour and a half in the morning just to get ready. Maybe I take care of some small things. I'm really prepping myself. And then, of course, after 8 o'clock in the morning, meetings consume you, right? So the day gets busy and I have to have that part in the morning where I know what I need to get done. So then as I navigate through the meetings through the majority of the day, I know that in blocks of time, I've got to still accomplish a few things. I've gotten a little bit wiser, I think, through the pandemic. So I block time in my calendar now because I have to. If you're back to back all the time, it feels like you don't really accomplish much of anything. Typical day is I do try to block a minimum of 30 minutes during lunch hour just to get up and walk around. I would say in this pandemic life, you're pretty much immobile a lot of the time. You're chained behind a desk and a screen, whereas pandemic, I would be commuting and walking around doing a lot more activities. So I would say my days have gotten busier through the pandemic, but I block more time for myself. And then I also make sure at the end of the day, I can decompress and say, okay, did I get everything I need to get done before I walk away? And I do try to walk away from the computer. So in the evenings, whatever time that might be, I don't take my work phone. Everything stays where it is. And I go to the other side of the house. So a typical day is sort of sad in the pandemic life. You wake up, you do your planning, you sit in a room all day. But I think there's lessons learned I've taken from the change of I do value the commute time that I don't spend in the car. And I've now repurposed that. I definitely enjoy the family time. And it made me realize like, hey, it's really important to have a meal with your family. And my wife has a very strict rule. No devices at the table because we want to have the conversation. And where our table is, where we eat, you can't see the TV. So a typical day is very different these days, but I will say it's made me reflect more on the time that's important for me personally to actually decompress, plan, and spend quality time with family.
That's awesome, man. And I consider you a very balanced person in that regard. And you can tell when a person isn't, but you, I think, are very balanced in that way. So what are the things that have really propelled your career forward the most?
It's probably a series of things. I attribute a lot to just being a good leader. So when people really understand that you have their best interests in mind, they're promoting for you, right? There's a sense of readiness that we look at. So as we think about a typical talent planning cycle with any company, you're always looking at who are your high performers, and you always look to who's always sort of responsive, who delivers quality, who's polished and always present in the meetings. And so there's a lot of factors that go into, I think, being looked at as someone that has that high potential. And so myself, I've always been very driven. I think my success really stems from a very young age. I don't know exactly what age I started, but I think, let's just say 12 years old, I had my own lawn mowing business in the neighborhood. You don't see kids doing this, but I would actually, at one point in time, I'm not kidding you, I think I had 16 yards around my neighborhood that I was to the point where I was doing roughly about three a day after school.
Wow.
And it got to the point where success brings more success. And so when you think about fundamentally, well, how did I get there? Was I a hustler and like getting people? Like, the truth was no. The truth was I was genuine with the customer. I always lived up to my word. So if I said, hey, I'll be there Wednesday, I would be there Wednesday. So there's a thing about living these behaviors. And so I ended up at a very young age being very successful in figuring out how to make money and how to run my own business. And I just kept continuing that work ethic all along. And I attribute a lot of that to my parents. My parents were very driven, both working professionals their entire life. So I think I appreciated what it meant to really earn your position, work hard to get where you want. And then I think I've just lived that throughout my entire career. It's not that I've been overly aggressive or demanding in terms of, hey, I need to get promoted. Never once in my career have I ever done that. I've never been a threatening type personality. If you live by your values and people start to see it, you'll naturally progress. And believe it or not, in the positions that I'm in, most of the time I didn't seek them out. People sought me out for these roles. And in my mind, that is very telling to say, I'm doing the right thing. Because if people are recommending you, that says something.
I imagine that one of the things that you do is just staying current and relevant in terms of being informed. What sort of things do you do to stay current and relevant?
I like to read, so I'll find things. And I'm one of these, sadly, I can't read a book cover to cover. I'm one that I generally jump around sometimes. And a lot of these leadership books allow you to do that, right? That you don't have to necessarily read cover to cover.
It's true.
But I would say one of the things that I've done a lot differently more recently, and I would say pre-pandemic, there was always networking events. There was always things going on you could go do. And honestly, some of those are draining, right? Because it takes a lot of time and maybe you get something out of it. But the networking part was important. It wasn't so much the agenda of whatever the meeting may have been. It was really what other people were going to be there. And through those conversations, keeping current with things that were going on. But I would say, with the pandemic, one thing I've really grown to appreciate is there's all sorts of groups that do these lunch and learns or these, you know, sessions where they bring in guest speakers. And a lot of times, and I'll be honest with you, Mark, this week I sat in on three of them. And they ranged from people that was, so we had a lieutenant general from Space Force in one. We had a leader, a director over in DARPA in another session. So it's really fascinating to just listen in and hear their perspectives. And quite honestly, the Q&A components are really great too, because people are asking really good questions. And it helps you build understanding of how are senior leaders and industry, you know, leaders really thinking about these problems. And right now, I think it's just been fascinating to listen to them as to how they're doing business. What are the threats they see? How are they adapting to the pandemic? How do you keep current? You have to make an investment of time, attend these sessions. It really matters, because it's very easy to get wrapped up in your day-to-day, and you can really get out of date, so to speak, of what's happening around you.
How important is someone's network in helping them advance their career or business?
Extremely important. It's really important the higher you go, right? Because I think reputation should always precede you, and hopefully in the best way. And as I mentioned earlier, the last two positions that I've had as a senior, I wasn't seeking out the role. People sought me out for the roles. And it all came through networks, every single one of them. It wasn't a blind call from a recruiter or executive search firm. It was actually because someone I had worked with in the past said, hey, you're the person I think is perfect for this role. And that made me make a big jump out of a previous employer that I'd been at for almost 21 years, because just the fact that this person knew me so well, and they said, you would fit this role. And then moving from there, it was another individual who said, I recommended you for this because of who you are and your abilities. And for me to go, wow, that's impressive. So your network really does matter. And I think one thing we always say, the world is very small, which is truthful, right? Because you never know when paths are going to cross. And so I'll give you a case in point, Mark. So we were trying to, a couple months ago, get a meeting with the chief of staff of an intel agency. And this is an easy thing to do, right? Because they're very busy people. Turns out that the assistant for this chief of staff used to be a very junior level government person that I happened to work with years past.
Wow.
And this individual recognized me on the email. And she was like, Rich, do you remember me? And it rekindled a conversation, but it made me reflect back to say, every morning that I'd pass by her cubicle as I was going to my desk, I would always make a point to say good morning or hello. And it made them feel like a real person. She remembered that. And you know what? She was bending over backwards, essentially, to help me get the meeting set up that I needed to have set up. And so when you say, does your network matter? Absolutely. And you never know how that network is going to look 5 years from now. But treating people with respect today will pay dividends at some point in the future. And so building those relationships, building that network, it does come back, and it is pretty powerful.
Is there anything that you do to keep up with folks in your network? I imagine with a network as vast as yours, it's probably difficult to keep up with, you know, hundreds or even thousands of people. But I imagine there's some percentage that you keep up with, but is there anything that you do intentionally? Like, I'm going to keep up with this person every so often. Just curious to know if you do it.
And Mark, I would say that is really hard because you're right. There's just too many people. And then it's just really hard to do that. And so one of the things that I've tried to get better at is in the moment, because sometimes it's weird how somebody flashes into your mind. Or like if I was talking to you and someone else, oh, you remember so-and-so, right? Like I try to, and honestly, again, I have a lot of post-it notes and papers. I'll go, oh, I haven't talked to him in a while. And I'll write his name down or her name down on the piece of paper. And I will make it a point to just reach out to them, whether it's through work, that if I work with them, or through LinkedIn, or just send them a quick message and just say, hey, checking in and seeing how you're doing. And what I tend to find is people are like, oh, wow, great to hear from you. And you do rekindle a little bit and catch up. And then, of course, that they fade back. But it's a rotation. You have to do this with people periodically just around your network. I would say I'm not the best at it. It's very easy just to be too busy. So I think it does take effort. And you really have to just make a point of, hey, when you think about someone, reach out to them in the moment. Because otherwise, that moment vanishes. And then another couple of years could pass before you actually talk to that individual.
How does a person become a good conversationalist?
I think you got to start the conversation off around a common interest. You got to find a way to break the ice, because I think what happens is if every conversation was directly to the point of the conversation, it's boring and it feels a little more formal. I think the way to really become a conversationalist is just to start talking about things that happen to you in the day, right? Or just a little small story. And I try to do this sometimes in some of my meetings, is just to have small talk. The great thing about these, you know, Zoom and WebEx and Teams, when people have their cameras on, you can say, oh, look at this, we're all wearing the same color shirt. So I think it's really about relating to the individuals. And it's surprising sometimes, and I think that's probably the more rewarding part of every conversation, is when you find a common connection, because you can generally get someone excited. And I'll be honest with you, this is how you win people over. I think back to a story years ago where I had a government contracting officer who was just a really hard personality. And so I set up these meetings with her periodically. And what I did, Mark, is I start every conversation just with a little bit of small talk. And eventually what I figured out, she was very passionate about her home community down in Georgia. And she would invest money into this community center. She would always be hosting events to bring people together. And so she told me kind of some things that I started to build upon. And guess what? I went back, I did a little research on some things she was working on. I said, hey, have you seen this? And I would bring stuff to her, and she got really excited. And so that conversation blossomed to where she became a huge advocate for us. But again, it comes through conversation. It comes through finding the common interest, things that build the trust. And it's hard and it takes effort. Again, another thing that you got to put a little effort into to build those relationships and have those meaningful conversations.
So I want to do something a little different and take the conversation in a slightly different direction. I want to do something called speed round. This is kind of fun. I'll say a word or a name of somebody in the news. Maybe it's a company, maybe it's a person. And you tell me the first word that comes to mind. Netflix.
Marvel series. My wife and I are on this Marvel
Yeah, yeah.
Netflix, and Netflix has some great ones.
COVID-19.
Change.
Pfizer.
Thankful.
Bitcoin.
Missed investment.
I could see that.
Apple.
Over-reliance.
I could see that too.
Tesla.
Expensive.
Anthony Fauci.
Celebrity.
Donald Trump.
Spotlight.
Spotlight. Joe Biden.
Old.
Elon Musk.
There's a lot with him. SpaceX.
You said there's a lot with him. What else would you say?
He's impressive. There's so much innovation and the ideas and the things that he's pushing. And I think about the Boring Company, which I think is a funny name, by the way. The SpaceX thing is just amazing. And the fact that he's reusing rockets and how they are, it's fascinating. And it's just, it's really mind blowing to go, wow, there's so much innovation. I mean, even through his cars, Tesla, there's things that you're just amazed at the technology and how far they've come. And he's done it in multiple dimensions. One of the premier entrepreneurs, you know, of our time.
Steve Jobs.
Missed.
Kim Jong-un, the leader of North Korea.
Unstable.
Amazon.
Everything.
And Disney.
Vacation.
Be nice to be there now.
All right, actually, my coffee mug, I don't know if you can see this, right? But it's all the world Mickeys from Epcot.
Oh, awesome. Awesome.
We are a Disney family. We haven't been, obviously, in the last, gosh, it's coming up on 2 years now, but we love Disney. And when people go, it's so expensive. And it's, yeah, there's a quality aspect. So when I say vacation, when you say Disney, there's quality, there's experience, there's expensive. You can say a lot of adjectives to describe it. The truth is, it is done so well that you are taken away into another moment. It's by no means a relaxing vacation. If I wear my Fitbit or Apple Watches, we're filling every circle. We're overachieving every day in terms of movement.
It's true.
But it truly is just fun. And it is something that is pretty remarkable in terms of a business model.
So I want to ask you some general questions, Rich. Just general advice and lessons learned questions. If you could share one secret of your success, what would that be?
I have to go back to saying building trusting relationships. It goes back to the network and having a reputation and people that are looking out for you as much as you look out for them.
What's the greatest lesson you've ever learned, either in life or in business?
Don't get consumed in the events or the actions that are beyond your control. I do this quite often as I can sometimes get stressed about a situation, which at the end of the day, I may have no control over. And so it's not worth the cycles to overthink it. I think do what you can, do what's within your span of control, and don't try to think too far ahead about the outcome, because there's so many things that can change in the interim.
If you could offer one piece of advice to the world, what would it be?
Find the time to do something you love. I really believe that you have to have that balance, as you mentioned earlier, the balance in your life, right? Because it's very easy to get consumed into your day-to-day things. You have to find something that you're passionate about and that you do that fulfills you, whether that's with family, whether that's through hobbies, whatever it is, find something that you really enjoy, because it'll make you a more balanced person.
What is that for you? What's that thing that you love?
Well, lately, I'm into a lot of things, but lately it's my competition barbecue.
Really?
Me and two buddies started a competitive barbecue team about 2.5 years ago. I know this is crazy. It's not a cheap hobby, but it is a fun hobby, because I used to pride myself on being a pretty good grill master. I'd be like, man, I can really do great things on my grill. What my wife did several years ago was, as a Christmas gift, she gave me a cookbook. And I was like, no, but it was an outdoor kind of smoking barbecue cookbook. She goes, that's not all. And she goes, open the book. I opened it up. It was basically a pass, or basically a ticket to go to pitmaster school. And she sent to Georgia to learn with Myron Mixon, who's one of the world, top world champion barbecue gurus. Spent 3.5 days at his, what he calls it, a compound, but it's his house and it's his backyard, but he has a really nice setup. And it changed my game completely. And it got to the point where it was really just for my ability to cook. But as we cooked for friends at parties, graduation things, everyone's like, your barbecue's so good, you ought to compete. And, nah, I'm not into that. Lo and behold, did a competition, and we placed in brisket in our first competition. We're like, that was the hook. The rest of the story is we went about a year and a half without winning anything else. But I will say this past year, and we've already had two competitions this spring, actually last month down in North Carolina.
Wow. We
placed both days in the competition.
That's amazing.
The meat categories. It's a great hobby. It does consume time. It's expensive, but it's a totally different life than what I do during the work week.
That is incredible. That is incredible.
There was a whole culture of barbecue I had no comprehension of until recently. And it's like amazing. It's really great people, just an amazing kind of culture around it.
Yeah.
And it's just people from all over the place. You've got ourselves, we're all executives in companies. And then the team next to you, the guy may own a catering business. And it's a lot of husband wife teams. It's just interesting, the people that you meet, and just it's a total disconnect.
Wow. I could see that. That's incredible, Rich.
So as we wrap up the interview, what do you want most for your life?
I want to know that I had an impact. I want to know that I impacted not just things for me, but for others. And I made everywhere that I was a better place.
It's a great answer. So at this point, is there anything that I haven't asked you? I've asked you a lot of questions, but is there anything else that you would want to share? Any final thoughts that you'd want to share with us?
I enjoy these conversations, Mark, and I probably could have answered every question differently if we did it all over again, too. There's so many answers to the questions. I think the inquisitive nature by which these sessions are great, because I think it makes people hear how people are thinking about something. So it goes all back to the reason that we're talking today is, how do you have effective dialogue? How do you listen to people, hear what they have to say? And then how do you take that information and do something with it? So my closing thought is, hopefully getting a little piece of my mind and how I've responded resonates with some of your audience. I know I take away from other conversations I listen to as well. So thank you for hosting.
Thank you for being on. Where can people find you and connect with you online?
I'd say LinkedIn's definitely the best for me, because I'm trying to downsize my apps in terms of where I spend my time.
No, that's great. Rich, thank you. This has been incredibly illuminating. You over-delivered as usual. Thank you so much for spending the time with me today.
It was my pleasure, Mark.
Hey guys, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, click the subscribe button to get the latest content and check out these other great clips from the podcast.